Okay, you know how this stuff works, don't you? Say yes. You can have, for all possible power converters or topologies, two ways of operation, modes of operation. You can have a mode of operation that is called CCM, that stands for continuous conduction mode. Or we can have another mode of operation that is called DCM, and D, guess what? Discontinuous conduction mode. And the difference is related to the behavior of the inductor power. In CCM, IL, the current flowing through the inductance, this is IL, the current flowing through the inductance, is always different from zero. In some cases, you can find IL is always larger than 0 amps. Here, it is always different from zero, except in one single point or so, in a limited number of points. DCM, you find sometimes, is when the IL is equal to zero in part of your cycle. This is not the best definition you can give for CCM and DCM. What is important is not the fact that the current is larger than zero or smaller than zero. That's the real fact is that the derivative of IL is zero or the derivative of IL is not zero. But this is what you find usually around the world. So it's not too bad, it's not too wrong. We just have to pay attention in this case for special circuits. Having CCM or DCM, working the system working CCM or DCM changes completely the behavior of the circuit. It's like in any case, a buck converter has the output voltage less than the input voltage, both in CCM or DCM. But when it is in CCM or in DCM, its behavior, its dynamic behavior, changes completely. It's like, I don't say Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, but almost. It's totally, a totally different circuit. And it's not enough looking at the schematic and say, oh, this is a buck converter working in CCM. You have to make calculations. If you have, and we will see this when it happens, if you have a CCM, a buck converter working CCM, you can move it to work in DCM without changing the components. Just changing some other parameters, but not the components. Or if you have a circuit working in DCM, you can change its working mode in CCM, just changes, for example, the load. You increase the load, you take more current out, and it moves from DCM to CCM. Distinguishing these two modes is important because the behavior of the circuit is totally different. Not just a little bit different, completely. In one case your circuit is stable, in the other case your circuit is unstable. It changes dramatically. So, we can analyze this circuit and all the other topologies. In this case, we have a buck converter using two techniques. There are many more, but I just want to mention two possible techniques to analyze this circuit. There is one is more mathematical, one is more engineering oriented. And the more mathematical way to analyze this circuit is this one. What what is the basic equation for an inductor?
VL
equals
VIL
by dt. And what is the basic equation for a capacitor?
IC
equals C
dVC by dt.
Remember, derivative is a linear operator, so we can, for example, take the average of both sides of this equation.
I can write
the average value VL on the left hand side equals the average on the right hand side. This is always true. Then, average and derivative are both linear operators. If we are not in a very complicated situation like infinite series, we can swap them. We can exchange derivative and average. So we can write down that this is equal to L d of IL average by dt equal VL average. This is true, we will use this equation. Now, and you can do the same exactly for the capacitor. Now, let's consider a cyclostationary condition. Cyclostationary condition means, what does it mean, cyclostationary condition, as I told you a moment ago?
The cycle.
Each cycle repeats exactly the same. So, let's take this average across one full cycle. Well, this is the value of IL, we have a given value. And what about the next cycle? It will be the same. What about the next cycle? It will be the same. If this is IL, we will derive it in a moment, but just to show what this, if our IL is something like this, and if then the average over one period of time, it will be the same average we have the next cycle, the average of the next cycle and so on. But look at this, this is not intriguing. If you take the average, not from here to here, but you take the average from any point to any other point, as long as you take the average for one period of this width, the cycle, the average will be always the same, because it's a periodic wave. If you want to say in a different way, let's say this. What is the average of a point? What does it represent?
The ratio of values on a certain period over the period.
Your colleague is telling something about the duty cycle. From an electrical point of view, what is the average of a point, of a current, or a voltage?
The integral.
Integral?
Divided by the
period. By the period. 1 over t, integral from 0 to t of the. What's that?
Continuous by.
It's the DC component, the continuous component. So, this is just the DC component of current flowing through the inductor, differentiated with respect to time. Now, it's going complicated. I told you it was mathematical. Now, if we are in cyclostationary conditions, the average current through the inductor is the same, because all cycles repeat exactly the same way, the same values. So how much is the derivative of a constant value?
Zero.
Oh no, wait, there is something wrong. Cannot like this. Because IL is not constant, IL is going up and down. But I take first the average and then I differentiate. If I take the average over here, just the geometrical average is just a constant value going between the maximum and the minimum. So, if we are in cyclostationary condition, this is equal to zero. Do you like this part? Tell me the truth, not tell me yes or no. No? Too much math? What is this telling you? This is telling you a very important fact. that an inductor for a DC component is just a piece of wire. Derivatives, average, linearity, an inductor for a DC component, only for a DC component, not for anything else, is just a piece of wire. It's a short. So the voltage across the inductor is zero. Average voltage across the inductor is zero. Instantaneous voltage is not. The average is zero. Is it really true that the average voltage across the inductor is zero? No, because you can have a real inductor. A real inductor has a resistance, and a DC current through a resistance makes a voltage drop. And it's not, it's against our initial hypothesis. We don't consider this voltage drop at the very beginning of our class. What about this part? We can say that IC average equals C by DVC average by DT. How much is this? Zero. This is just telling you that the capacitor for DC is not conserved. There is no current flowing through the capacitor if there is a DC voltage across it. And derivatives is a linear operator. So if you have DC voltage plus a DC voltage, you can take two separate derivatives. The derivatives of the constant part, the constant term, is zero. The capacitor for a DC voltage is an open circuit. Like isolation dielectric, other plate, this is a capacitor. What does it mean if you have a constant current to a capacitor when you apply a constant voltage? Let's suppose you have a capacitor, you apply a voltage, a constant voltage across it, and you have a constant current flowing through it. What does it mean? Capacitor? No, because it's a constant. Constant voltage and you have a constant current. It means that your capacitor failed. It's time to change it. Okay, so using these equations, let me just rewrite them. VL equals zero, IC average equals zero. Under what conditions these two equations are true? Cyclostationary conditions. If these two conditions are, we have the cyclostationary condition, we have these two equations holding true, and we can apply these equations to this inductor, this capacitor, and we can find out the relationship between input and output. Good luck, just math, and you can go. It works. Very easy to have it working, but I don't like it. This, by the way, is the kind of approach that you find on the Erikson-Maximowicz Fundamentals of Power Electronics. It's very rigorous, it's very precise, it's exact. But my engineering spirit is saying, maybe there is something else that you can do. The something else is the second kind of analysis that I will show you in a moment. It's something long, it takes more time. But you see what's going on in your circuit. And what is important for me is that you understand what's going on in your circuit. And the idea, if we leave these equations here, we use another approach, is something like this. It's exactly the same, you get the same result, it's basically the same idea, but I prefer this approach. It is, analyze, analyze is too complicated, find out IL, and let me just express it here, function of T. I want the real actual IL that you can see with the scope and the current probe in your cell. And that will be the technique we will use for all converters in this class. We got time domain, we put over here IL. This bit, please. Every time you make a graph, you put two axes like this, write down what is on the axis. You have to tell me this is time and that is current. And let's analyze what happens inside one cycle. This cycle has a duration of T. T-switch, the switching period. And after this T-switch, there will be another one the same, then another one the same, and so on. Let's suppose to work with CCM. What does CCM mean? Continuous conduction mode. What is the actual meaning of CCM? Current never goes
to zero.
To zero and stay to zero. Or current never is constant. What is important is that it stays constant. If it stays constant, if the derivative is zero, it's okay. It's a DCM. If we are in CCM, at the beginning of this cycle, current will be different from zero. We'll have an initial value. And this is the initial. Where is it coming from? This is a heritage, this initial current, this initial condition is a heritage from what?
The previous cycle.
The previous cycle. And this one will be the same. So how many cycles do we have in the left hand side of this graph? Infinite. Well, no, infinite is too much, but a lot. We have a steady state condition, cyclostationary condition. We got the switch during a phase T on. We close our switch for a time T on. Obviously T on has to be less than T switch, otherwise we just pass into the next cycle. And if I close this switch, what happens to this inductor? What happens to this current to the inductor? Well, I want to find out what the current to the inductor. So I know that, how is the inductor equation that I forgot? VL equals L D I L by D T. L equals D I L by D T. So, if I close the switch, what is the voltage across the inductor? Oh, this is a very complicated differential equation. We have to integrate it. But we integrate it, let me say, graphically, on our graph, on our waveform. How much is the voltage across the inductors when the switch is closed?
V minus.
On the left hand side, there is
input
voltage. Is it really true?
No.
Because there is a voltage drop
on the switch.
Across the switch. But that is the first lecture. Don't go to complicated stuff. Let's neglect this voltage drop. Oh, by the way, if you are good guys, you can try to ask Santa Claus for Christmas to have an ideal switch. But I don't think you will get it. For many reasons. One is that
it doesn't exist.
Santa Claus does not exist. So, no idea. There is a small voltage drop over here. Just now, for today, we neglect. So, on the left hand side of our inductor, there is a voltage that is referred to this point, is the in. What the voltage on the right hand side of the inductor? That is the out. So the voltage across the inductor is V with minus L. So I can write here that is V, T, but I don't want to write V minus V. No. If I have a constant voltage across the inductors, what happens to the current to this inductor? If I put a constant in this forcing term, this differential equation, what happens? I have that this derivative is constant. Actually, this derivative, I can write that this derivative is d I L by d t equals v a minus v naught over L. Over on the other side, v minus v naught over L equals d I by d t. And we have almost solved our differential equation. But I want to solve it on the graph. What is di by dt on this graph? Geometrically. That's the slope of the current from this point on. Is this slope going up or going down? V in is larger than in other, so the slope is positive. And so my current will go up as long as I keep my switch closed, and this slope has a value of, what is the value of this slope? V A minus, did I write the V I? No, this log is V in minus V naught over L. I have A, I have V naught, or I will find V naught actually, I have L, or I will design L, but this is just a plan. I should follow my circuit is given, I figure out how it works. V minus V naught over L. That's like 10 volts minus 5 volts divided by 50 microamps. And the result will be 10 minus 5 divided by 50, 0.1 volt. What are the units for this quantity?
Ampere per second.
Amps per second. Or, if you want to avoid the numbers that are so big, amps per microsecond. Because our times are easily measured in microseconds. And if you go by amps per second, you get 300,000 amps per second or so. Amps per microsecond is better than this. Oh, remember, some of you already know it. If you have to do your mental math to estimate the results, you have to work with numbers that are small, integer, and positive. 300,000 is not small. You cannot visualize 300,000, and at least I am unable to. But 0.3 n per microsecond, well, it's not integer, but it's okay. So this will be our ramp up portion of our IL. After a time t on, I, the controller, decide voltages. Switch is open, current was flowing to the right and to the inductor, and what happens? Current to an inductor is like a freight train, phenomenal. It's hard to start it, but once it travels, it's very hard to break to stop it. So this current was flowing to the right, you open the switch, it keeps flowing to the right. So this is a double, so your freight train going to the right. And so current is not cannot come from the switch anymore because it is open. Fortunately, there is this diode, and this diode switches off, turns on, and allows the current to flow to the diode. Notice when the switch is closed, this diode is reverse biased because it is positive on the cathode and the negative at the end, so it's a reverse bias, it's open. But the moment you open the switch, the voltage across the inductor makes everything that you can in order to keep this current going. And it starts to come up from the diode. And what is the voltage at this point? When the switch is off.
Minus VD.
I would say negative VD. There is a difference between minus and negative. At least if you want to be very cool, very precise. Minus is the...
If we consider the ground, the negative...
Yes, this is zero. But it's just a linguistic fact. Minus and negative are two different things. This is 3 minus 5. This is a minus because it's an operator between two operands. Equals how much is 3 minus 5? Negative 2. And on your calculator, you have two different keys. This is the minus key, this is the negative key. Nobody takes care of anyway, voltage during this phase is here negative VD, the voltage drop across the diode, but this is the first lecture, guys. Almost at the end, the first lecture. So, zero. Here the voltage is zero, here the voltage is V naught. Oh, we are using the third hypothesis I made. That is, there is no output voltage ratio. The output voltage is constant, there is no variation in the output. It's not true, but this variation is small, it's negligible with respect to the voltage across the inductor, so we can just affect the difference. And so, the voltage across these inductors is V naught, because they have V naught on this side and zero on the other side. Is it right? better not. Because if I say that the voltage over here has been altered during T off, it means that I am taking the positive side of the inductor on the right hand side. I am changing the sign convention, the sign that I put here earlier on the previous graph, on the previous period. It's okay, but I cannot, if I swap the two signs, I cannot go on to draw the same graph. Because in this graph, the voltages are taken with the positive on the right on the left hand side. So the voltage over here is not V naught, but is
minus.
Negative evolution. And so my car will start to come down till the end of the cycle. What's the slope during this descent?
Minus V naught.
Negative V naught over F. I am the only individual that I know that distinguishes between minus and negative. Everybody else is just not there. Okay, we have two slopes. How long is this period of time? This period of time is called P of, because during this period of time the switch is off. What happens over here? Next time, it restarts, the on, the off, the on, the off, and it repeats for that. How much is this value, this current value, with respect to the initial current value? How much is the final current value compared to the initial current value?
The same.
How is it possible? Are you so lucky that you control exactly the T on and T off, etc., to get the final value exactly the same as the of the initial value? You are solving two differential equations, guys. Are you so lucky to get the final value exactly equal to the initial value?
Yes.
But you are not lucky. You are imposing it. You want to be there. You want to be there. Like this. And so, you can say that this climbing up curve is equal to this climbing down curve. The sum of this ascent plus this descent is zero. Not because you are lucky, but because you are imposing this condition, because you are analyzing the cyclostationary condition. And so, you can easily find out the relation that turns out to be from this consideration. And you have that V minus V naught over L, this is the going up slope, times the duration, time interval where this slope is 2, that is times V on, plus the second slope, and the second slope is
negative
plus negative V naught over L times P off. How much is this? If we are in cyclostationary conditions, this is equal to. And if we are not in cyclostationary conditions, and next month we will see. This is equal to zero. Mm-hmm. And so we can cancel out the L and L. It means that the value of L is not important on the relationship between the input and the output voltage. If we cancel out the L and L, we get that V in times V on equals, and move all the negative quantities to the right hand side, equals V naught times V on plus V off. And with very difficult algebraic manipulations, we get V naught over V in equals P on divided by P on plus P off equals, what is P on plus P off?
Switch
period. Equals P on over the switch, and if you consider the control signal that goes to the switch that says close, open, etc. This is the time when the signal is active divided by the total time, period length, this is called
duty cycle.
Duty cycle. and this is D. So the ratio, output voltage divided by the input voltage equals to D, is the ratio. Duty ratio can go from 0 to 1, so the output voltage can go from 0 to infinite. Is it true? Is this result? No. No, because we made a lot of assumptions. A few of them are okay. Did I use the first assumption that what was the first assumption? The idea switches. Yes, I do, because otherwise, here, I don't have Vin minus V0 over L. If I use real switches, I should say Vin minus the voltage drop above the switch, V switch, minus V0 over L equals, this is not negative V0 over L, will be negative V0 plus Vd over L. But this is still a simple equation. Hypothesis I made, we will remove it later on, but it's not difficult. Just put here minus V switch, just put here plus Vd, and that is okay. Second hypothesis I made,
time constant
are far longer than the period of time. Yes, because I said the output voltage is constant, okay, and even if I have a resistance over here, so series with the inductor, the time constant L over R is so long compared to T on, T off, that I don't see any effect. So long means that L over R, R is so small that my efficiency is basically 1. This whiteboard, why did I forget my color choice? This whiteboard is not a straight line going up, it's a exponential going up. Actually, it's not even an exponential because the output capacitor starts to kick in and it will be a partial sinusoid. But for this short period of time, this is just staying. So the second hypothesis here, and this is a good hypothesis, I mean, we'll never remove it because it's okay. Third hypothesis is output voltage has no ripple. This is a, we will evaluate, we will find out how much is the output ripple, but it's not giving me a big difference for the fact over here. Because the voltages across inductance are V minus V0 or V0. The ripple, usually, is a few percent of V0. So it's not a big contribution. So you see that the three or four hypotheses, four hypotheses, the cyclostationary condition, the four hypotheses we made, we use them. Some of them will be holding true for all our class, some of them will be holding true just in part of our class, some of them will be removed. Okay, but it was just the first lecture. Okay? See you on Friday. Going on this stuff. Yes, no?